Maybe now.
Today morning, I think some of you must have read one article which has appeared in Hindu, just professor was mentioning me. What you feel about it? I was sure that kind of questions would be coming to me after I learned through some of the slides where I would like to give some of my experience working on GM crops or leading the institution which is working on GM crops. In fact, it reminds me of my days in University of Nanaimo when genetic modification was in the experimental stages when I was a grad student in 1990s. I was wondering whether these GM crops will actually enter our farmer's field, because I am also a farmer's son. But after 25 years, I think they are in our fields now. And also in 2000, I was also in the midst of a crisis, you can say, before the crops were entering our fields for commercialization in 2002, when government approved. Practically, farmers' organizations were there to burn even our experimental fields, because I was heading a research station in Shiruguppa, which is near Tungabhadra belt, which is known for cotton. And incidentally, I became head of the same university, which is involved in transformation. Probably no other technology has been scrutinized so much like GM technology. When some of the institutions, public institutions, were involved in genetic transformation for eggplant, that is brinjal, U.S. Darwad was also one of the partners. And in fact, a case is there in the Supreme Court to decide some of the violations some of our scientists have committed. Anyway, so just to tell that, I have seen different phases of this technology. Probably all of you are also aware of the fact that no other technology in science and technology which has been scrutinized so much before its release or even after its release. Because we say that Bt cotton has entered our fields and nearly about 90% of current cotton cultivation in India is from Bt cotton, genetically modified cotton. But still we are debating, we are still wondering whether it should be continued for other crops or not. I think just to share some of these things, I have collected as much of information as possible for this esteemed body so that we can also have our own opinions. I am not pro or anti also. I am just sharing my experience and sharing the knowledge which is there for this GM technology. Since we have some of the issues, for each scientist, in fact, you have listened to our own agriculture minister yesterday, of course it is on a different topic, but he is of the firm opinion that scientists spend a lot of time in developing the technology, but they fail to communicate to the stakeholders or to the public or to the society, ultimately, for which the technology has to be utilized. He is of the firm opinion. So that is why as soon as he assumed the charge of agriculture minister in our state, he gave a direction to the university. You people are all involved in developing the technology, but you fail to communicate to the society. First, try to convince the stakeholders, that is farmers, ultimately the farmers, because this technology has different kinds of opinion, not based on science. Many times it is based on the other than the science issues on which this GM technology has been scrutinized over the years. I think it will be continued even in future also when you start getting some more products from this one. So that is why I will just briefly run over the slides, because I have collected a lot of information so that will give a glimpse of how these crops will be developed, what kind of crops will be there in store for the future generations and other things. We see a lot of crops today, whether it is cotton, whether it is tomato, whether it is brinjal, they have been evolved over years. From their wild status or from their weed status, by what we call conventional methods of crossing and selections, how our new varieties have been developed. But now we are talking about GM technology, because these conventional methods have been used for crop improvement programs over years to develop one variety or one improved hybrid. Normally we spend, scientists spend about 10 to 12 years, but with this GM technology, it can be reduced to half. About 5 to 6 years, still will be in a position to come out with the variety. But the most important thing about the advantage of this GM technology is crossing the barriers. We can cross the barriers of these species. Because in conventional methods, we will be crossing only the parents of the same genus or parents of the same species. If it is cotton, one cotton species is crossed with another cotton species, or within the species also one cotton parent is crossed with another cotton parent. But here we are talking about a GM technology wherein totally different species, DNA from totally different species can be brought and put into plants. That is where the problem comes, or some of the advantages as well as the concerns that have been debated over years will be analyzed here. And of course, undesirable traits in conventional methods, there could be, because we have seen a lot of wild species and other things, they will be also transferred when you make crosses. But in this GM technology, undesirable, because it is very specific. When we know that a particular trait is controlled by a single gene, we'll be transferring only that particular gene and it will be put into plants. So that is why undesirable trait transfer in GM technology is practically nil. But certainly about this issue, the last one is biosafety issues. We don't require any biosafety for crossing it within the plants, within the cotton or within the tomato or within the rice. We don't require any biosafety issues because two species of the same plant will be crossed there and the new product will be there, whether it is variety or hybrid. But because of this crossing the barriers, plants may be crossed with genes from bacteria. That's what ultimately we are going to talk about, Bt cotton. So here, DNA from this Bacillus thuringiensis, Bt is, of course, if you are not aware, some of the students from different background. I mean, one good thing about this body is we have a mix of people who have different interests, different backgrounds. So that is why, though it looks very elementary or preliminary for some of the biologists, I thought let me tell how this Bt or Bacillus thuringiensis, which is a soil bacterium, DNA from that is put into cotton plants to make it some toxic for a particular group of insects, because cotton is affected by several pests. In that one, bollworms are the worst affecting group of insects. In fact, they were the major pests. Nowadays, again, I will come to that. Once we take care of this bollworms through this Bt technology, we are having some other problems for Bt cotton. So this Bt has been transferred, which is a soil bacteria, and the gene has been isolated and put into cotton plant, wherein cotton plant has become toxic for only that particular group of insects. This is most important aspect that we as scientists failed to impress upon the farmers, even the general public, who always think that when a cotton plant can become toxic, it can be toxic to everybody. This is a general transformation methods which are commonly used. Agrobacterium mediated transformation, that is normally used for most of the dicot plants. And we have one more gene gun. It is a simple gun, just like in our Holis. Kids will start playing with a gun. It is working on the same principle. So the DNA from the any desired gene construct will be embedded with the golden particles and it will be shot into the tissue cultured plantlets, which are about to be regenerated, and ultimately we'll start getting the transformed plantlets. Any of the methods can be used, but these are generally used to develop the genetically modified plants. But let me tell you about the status so that I will quickly run over. Of course, in 1996, that was the first year when commercial release of this GM crops was there. It was hardly about 1.7 million hectares, and now it is about 181. Nearly 28 countries are going there, and about 9 crops are there. And major traits in which GM crops have been developed are insect or herbicide or disease resistance. One thing you please remember, none of these GM crops are aiming for higher yields. They are only to take care of these biotic or abiotic stresses. So pests and diseases are the major problems for agricultural crops. Many times this is the confusion that public has. GM crops means higher yields. No. GM crops can take care of your pest or disease for which a specific gene is identified and put into the plant system. Only because of the control of those stresses, you will get some additional yield, and also you will see a lot of returns to the farmers, because farmers, particularly cotton farmers, if you are from the cotton belt, 15 to 20 sprays people used to take to control these bollworms. 15 to 20, particularly those who are from Ballari area, Tungabhadra area, when cotton was really ruling, I think they know the flight of number of sprays they used to take. Even if you are passing by the highway, I think you used to smell the pesticides usage. So the adoption rate, of course, soybean very high. I think I have a couple of slides where you can see the over the years from 1996 to 2014, you have a tremendous increase. I think it is still going on in different countries as well. You can see the GM crops, particularly in North America and South America. Maximum adoption is there, 28 totally countries. And you can see even over India, China, Australia. Barely they are making inroads in African continent. So maximum GM area is under soybean, maize, cotton and canola. Of course, we are talking about only cotton in India. We are yet to get entry for these other crops. That's where the debate is going on, I'm sure that some of you must be aware. And again, when you compare the adoption rate in industrialized countries or developing countries, you can see it is almost tapering in both groups of countries. But total adoption is really increasing over years. And particularly, I was talking about these traits in which one I mentioned about bollworms, but another group is herbicides. Of course, in our country, herbicides are still new. They are yet to find a place. But in North America or Europe, where they have a larger holdings and they don't have a labor surplus that countries like India and China can enjoy. Of course, no, we cannot say the same situation, because here also we are facing a lot of problems as far as availability of labor in rural areas. Or those who are involved in agriculture, they can also resort to these herbicides in a bigger way. But there are some herbicides which can be used. But private companies, they are coming up with this herbicide tolerant genotypes. That is another group of GM crops which are waiting in queue for the clearance from the government of India. And as I mentioned, soybean is maximum as far as adoption rate is concerned. Particularly in the US, all soybean or even maize. Practically, you take anything in US, maize and soybean, particularly Midwest US, we say, they are the belts of this corn as well as soybean. Oil is there, everything that is modified. In fact, let me tell you my own experience, because of course I'll tell you when I'm talking about tomato. Tomato was the first GM crop which has been released in 1996, flavor saver, that is the one of the variety. Of course, it is modified to have a longer shelf life. As I told you, as a graduate student, I was in the US and we used to see the labels, genetically modified tomato, for these flavor saver tomatoes which were in the market. We were so curious as a graduate student, we used to bring them to our rooms and keep it outside the fridge and watch how long it will take for rotting actually. It used to go for really up to 1 month period without any rotting. That is the advantage of this GM technology. I have seen with my own experience of looking at genetically modified tomato as well as the normal tomatoes which we brought from market. Just keep them outside. So GM tomatoes can retain their shelf life for nearly about 1 month period without losing the taste and other things. This is just I am telling you about the different countries wherein GM crops have entered. And including BT brinjal, which we talk and I'll touch upon that also. Our neighboring Bangladesh has allowed to be cultivated. And these are all the different traits for which GM crops are available, commercially available. Cotton is having maximum countries wherein 14, maize, soybean, and just some of the crops including brinjal, they are allowing it in different countries. This is one good example, because cotton is next important crop in India as a commercial crop. The major economy, Indian economy, comes from cotton. So here, as I was mentioning, nearly about 15 to 20 sprays if people are taking to control these bollworm attacks, they can be practically stop spraying to these bollworms if this BT technology is adopted. This fact was not known to farmers groups, though the same farmers groups who started burning the experimental fields, they started realizing the importance of this technology. Then they started making queues in front of these dealers or the seed suppliers who went on selling, including fake seeds, including all spurious seeds. You have seen a lot of reports over the years. But as of now, nearly 95% of our entire cotton area in the country is under BT cotton. This is just a brief note on Bacillus thuringiensis, the bacteria from which a gene has been identified and transferred to cotton. It is from soil. Though they say that this BT has a lot of bad effects, it is available freely in the soil. You take the soil, you just hold it, all the Bacillus thuringiensis will be there, adhering to your hands. But it is not a new thing, it has its old history. Right from 1901, wherein this BT has been used from Japan, it was first reported, and up to 2002, wherein the commercial application of this BT into the GM plants has been summarized in this one. And in fact, this is one good advantage, including even before the transformation of this BT into crops, it was even supplied as a pre-fodder for control of different insect pests. But this is the one of the widest application, you can say, when it was introduced in cotton and made a success out of this one. And this protein is very specific. I want you to draw your attention, particularly it is insoluble in acidic situation. This protein, when you put this BT gene in cotton plant, it produces a lot of proteins. And those proteins are insoluble in acidic condition, so they are safe to humans, because you all know we have acidic situation, hardly 1.5 to 2 is our pH. But when we are talking about the insects for which it is being targeted, bollworms, it is having alkaline pH, 9.5, wherein these proteins are soluble. This is the scientific basis on which we have to argue, or we have to convince that they are safe for all non-target organisms. And the protein, once it is soluble, particularly in high pH conditions, which is found in the midgut of Lepidopteran pests, that's what we are talking about, bollworms. See, this is the midgut wherein the pH is around 9.5, and these proteins will be dissolved, and they have a specific binding sites in the larvae. Then only those dissolved proteins will go and adhere to the cell wall in the midgut, and they create ruptures. That is how the bollworm will be killed. This is a very simple mode of action that we have for BT. But it is very safe to all other crops, including organisms, including the very minute pests on cotton itself, they will not be controlled by that. We have jassies, thrips, some other leaf-eating caterpillars and so many things, which will not be killed by this BT. This is very much safe for other non-target organisms, because neither those insects nor human beings nor the animals that many reports you must have read, like sheep, cows, so many things, they will have alkaline pH in their intestine or gut, nor they have a binding sites. Because once this protein is dissolved in such a high pH condition, it needs a binding site. So they are all absent in other non-target organisms, so that is why they are very safe. So only for bollworms or Lepidopteran pests, which is the group of insects, in fact it is a major group of insects which devastates all the agricultural crops, not just cotton, we have so many other crops like pod borer in Tur, that is red gram, presently all dal that we are eating, we are also having BT Tur in that one, including rice, they have some group of insects which are affecting them. For all those crops, I think we can transform BT and control those pests. So that is why it requires very specific conditions to be more effective. So it has no toxic effect on human beings or other animals, because we have our acidic stomach, very low pH, and absence of required receptors or binding sites. This is scientific basis. This has to be communicated to all the public or even farmers who started opposing at that point of time, scientific community failed to convince this.
Sir, has the study covered the entire spectrum?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Of the biological diversity.
I will show you. I think I will come to that once. Then I will quickly go. I am sure curiosity is getting more, but it is also host specific, so it will not affect other groups. I will quickly show you. These are all the different genes that are available, which have been transformed. Look at the activity, Leptospermum larvae. Only these groups will be affected, not for other things. And these are all different 50 genes which have been used and which are being transformed into different groups. Not only cotton, even in other crops also, they are getting into other crops. And now I will talk about other group of GM crops, that is herbicide resistant crops. I was talking about herbicides which are extensively used in North America and Europe, particularly for soybean and maize. And one weedicide which is widely used is glyphosate or Roundup, that's what we call. If you spray that, it practically wipes out everything, including crops. But these private groups, they have introduced that herbicide tolerant gene into the crops. That's what I observed in the 90s when one of my own friend from India was working on herbicide resistant soybean at that point of time. It was in very initial stages. I was really wondering, it doesn't affect your soybean or corn wherein this herbicide resistant gene is introduced, but that particular herbicide can kill everything else other than these two crops. You can imagine the revolution that it can create, particularly in such bigger land holdings wherein herbicides are order of the day. But still in India we are not using, but still, just recently, as per the direction of our minister, we are having a lot of interaction meetings with farmers who are ultimately the users of this technology, wherein farmers are asking now. You remember, we had a lot of consultation meetings when Jairam Ramesh was environmental minister in the previous government with all the stakeholders. At that point of time, the situation was different, and now farmers are asking why government is not coming forward for release of these other technologies. You have released because they have seen the advantages of BT cultivation. But they want to know why you are not allowing this Roundup Ready cottons or Roundup Ready other crops also. Just recently I had an interaction meeting of nearly 400 to 450 farmers from all over the state, for which our minister was also there. So that is the kind of urge now in the minds of farmers, that government should not become a stumble block. But still, nearly about 90% of the farmers express that they should allow other crops. But about 8 to 10% of the farmers, they say, still oppose it. We are not pro, but we want to collect the views of all the stakeholders so that government can take decision. That is what the interest of our Krishna Berigoda, who is very much interested to know the pulse of the people. Ultimately, the farmers, what they feel. Ultimately, the general public. That is why he was very happy when I said I am interacting with NIA's faculty on this crops. He wants to know even the pulse of the well-known scientific community also, though they are all from different backgrounds like nuclear science, engineering science, but still, when you are given the appraisal about the technology, what you feel? Because even in our scientific community also, about 8 to 10% of the scientists also are having some apprehension about the long-term effects. I will also clear some of these apprehensions based on our own experimentation in our institution, wherein we are maintaining long-term plots of BT and non-BT cottons. I think this is the 8th year I am maintaining personally these long-term trials, wherein all the apprehensions that farmers used to express over cultivation of these BT over years, it will deplete, or it will make the soils unproductive. It will kill your biota and other things. I think I will share some of those things. This glyphosate I was talking about, Roundup Ready, it affects one particular enzyme which is required in that pathway, EPSP enzyme. Based on that one only, the Roundup Ready or RR Ready crops are being developed. So this gene allows, if it is sensitive, this gene will be, this particular enzyme will be removed and the plants will be killed. So why glyphosate is more effective for all the crops means because it affects EPSP synthase enzyme in this pathway. But when you put genetically modified glyphosate resistant genes, then it can make the only plants as tolerant, all other vegetation will be killed. That is the advantage of this Roundup resistant plants. So we are having a lot of such crops, including the virus resistant papaya. We have papaya ring spot virus that has been modified through this technology. This is another BT brinjal technology which has been debated for the entire country when they were about to almost clear, but because of a lot of apprehensions and lobbying by different groups, they put a moratorium for about 10 years. And in fact, our university has ready-made BT brinjal seeds. They are in the field. We are not allowing them to go out of our laboratories. But Bangladesh has recently cleared, last year, they are allowing. I heard some reports it has entered already West Bengal. They have their own way to bring this technology. But certainly, the pesticides that are being used on the consumables or vegetables like this, I'm sure here people must have realized when you buy vegetables in the market, one good thing is you bring your vegetables and just wash in warm water, a thin layer of oily layer will be seen in your water. That's nothing but all the pesticides that have been dumped on the vegetables. If you see those, I'm sure you will stop eating the vegetables. That is the kind of pesticides they are being used, particularly in these urban and peri-urban areas. Wherever you are close, particularly bigger cities like Bangalore, even Dharwad is no different than this one. All surrounding areas, practically they dump these vegetables, particularly cauliflower. Let me scare you by not to eat cauliflower. They practically take this cauliflower and just immerse in the solution before they bring it to the market. Because whatever the little worms or insects they are there inside the heads, they will all be killed. But you just imagine if you don't wash them properly. So that is why at least you take warm water and put some salt in that. That will at least clear off the pesticide residues. That is what just one piece of advice I give you. Major reports, you can imagine the amount of pesticides that were put into the environment that could have been reduced because of this technology. And in fact, more than 39 to 40% sprays have been reduced. Still the profit has been increased. And yield gain is about 30%. So I already indicated that this technology is not for just improving the yield, but because of the control on pests and diseases, I think we are getting a yield advantage of 25 to 30% all over the country. This is the summarized results over since from 2002 to 2012, and you can see the reduction of pesticide usage in India. I think environment should be more safe, more promising, so that you can sustain it over generations. You can see the amount of reduction that you can see on all pests, including particularly cotton bollworms. It has come down to hardly 3%. So bollworms were the major pests. But now all of a sudden, resurgence of some of the minor pests which were not requiring any pesticide sprays are becoming more prominent, like sucking pests in the early stages itself. Because this BT cotton technology is very specific, and right from about 50 days up to 110 days, we need an active production of this BT toxins in the plants, because during that phase only these bollworms will be more active. But before 50th day, all those sucking pests, earlier we used to take some sprays and those pests were almost under control. Now all of a sudden these sucking pests have become major pests for cotton. So those are the new problems, and some more pests are coming. And look at the advantages that have been seen. Not only in Karnataka, even over the country, 43% area increase is there because of this BT technology. Production 64%, I'm talking about all India average. But look at the phenomenal increase in Karnataka, particularly the productivity, 139% productivity is more. It is only because of the BT cotton. Because I told you, in our state, it is almost 98%. All over India, it is about 90%. So it is only because of this one, I think even the Indian productivity has been improved, 537 kgs, and Karnataka it is more than national average, that is 626. So these are total uploaded. I will quickly go over. I will not take so that I can give you more time for interaction to give my view. Nearly we have 375 events at a global level. Recently, South Korea in May 18, they have given one more clearance for this herbicide tolerant event. Malaysia has recently cleared for maize. Even Philippines is being used. And these crops are under regulation. I